but not a home. Was a picture Satan painted for sweet little sister and me. Our daddy would frown while mother was praying. His heart was so burdened that he would not believe. In anger he swore, his voice cold and loud. His Sundays were spent out with the gambling crowd. I've never seen my daddy inside the house of God. Old Satan held his hand down the path of sin he'd trod. Not long ago, our circle was broken when God called our mother one night. With a voice sweet and low, her last words were spoken, asking our daddy to raise her children right. Rejoiced in heaven last night. I heard daddy pray, dear God, make it right. He was smiling and singing with tears in his eyes, while mother with the angels rejoiced last night. Thank you. one more rosebud. For his garden made of love. So he took our little darling home with the angels up above. Now don't be sad, my mommy darling. Wipe those teardrops from your eyes. You and Daddy, I know, will meet me in that garden in the sky.
In Matthew chapter 14, when the disciples was on the ship in the midst of the sea, being tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And on the fourth watch of the night, Jesus came unto them walking on the sea. But when they saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a spirit." But straightway Jesus spake unto them and said, "Be of good cheer. it is I, be not afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me to come unto thee on the waters. And the Lord said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the waters to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. And beginning to sing, he cried, saying, Lord, save me. Now you know Peter was doing fine as long as he had his eyes on Jesus. But when he looked out into those rushing waves around him, I imagine that old Satan began to start talking to him and said, Peter, who do you think you are? Do you really think that you're walking on those waters? That's when old Peter started doubting. And then when he started to sink, Jesus stretched forth his hands and caught him and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? Being taught through this world of trials and temptations, we are very much the same as old Peter. If we want to keep our eyes on Jesus, then we must walk for him and not the pleasures of this world.
Keep your eyes on Jesus when the tidal waves of trouble around you roll. Keep your eyes on Jesus. He will calm the storms of life that cost your soul. Been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Through.
detour to heaven. No rough road along the way. I'm using my Bible for a road map. My last stop is heaven's country day.
Begins in the state of Texas somewhere around the turn of the century at a little one-room frame schoolhouse that had been torn by strife and trouble so bad that they just couldn't keep a teacher to teach the boys and girls. By reason of this, they had grown larger and older, more harder to handle, and the teacher just couldn't seem to control them. In fact, the last one left in tears. The young folks had grown so terrible that he just couldn't seem to cope with it and handle them at all. And for a few weeks, they went without a teacher, and finally, after running an ad in the paper, a young man appeared there and told them, "I'd like to apply for the job." They explained the situation to him, and after they'd explained, he still told them, "I'd like to have the job and see what I can do with it." On his first day in school, as he met the class, and they looked him over and began to laugh at him and to mock him and to poke fun at him and tell him, "We'll get rid of you soon." But he looked back at them and he told them, "I want to make a bargain with you, one I believe will help you. And I can't take care of you and I can't look after you, but I'm going to let you govern yourself. I'm going to let you set the rules. Make the rules according to the punishment that you want to give. And we're going to let you be the judge. We're going to let you administer the punishment." There was one boy in this group especially who had grown larger than the rest, and none of the teachers was able to reach or to handle. Constantly he caused them trouble. And he spoke up in the time they were making the rules, and he said, "Teacher, it's been so here at the schoolhouse that theft and stealing has been rampant." And of course this young man was at the head of it. But laughingly he said to him, "I'd like to make a rule that whoever is found stealing will have 15 lashes laid on his bare back without a shirt." And the teacher said, "All right," and the rules were made and some others included. Finally, a few days went by, and this young man who had asked for these rules stepped up in the class and said, "Teacher, somebody stole my lunch. It's gone. I can't find it." They began to inquire around the room, and they began to ask, "Have you seen anybody take anything that they shouldn't have?" And finally, a little boy stepped up to them, very frail in appearance, dressed very shabbily. And he said, "Teacher, I took his lunch and I ate it." And he said to him, "Then Johnny, why did you take the boy's lunch? Why did you steal it?" And he said, "Well, teacher, as you know, my mom is dead. My daddy's not able to work. He can't look after us like he should. I didn't have any breakfast this morning. In fact, I had no supper last night." And as he stood there with tears in his eyes, the teacher said, "Johnny, I'm sorry, but you'll have to pay the price. You'll have to take the punishment, or our whole system will break down, and we're getting along so well." He said, "All right, teacher, I'll take the whipping." But the teacher said to him, "Johnny, you'll have to take off your coat." And as they looked at him, he had a coat wrapped around him that was too large, pinned together the collar with a large catch pin, and the sleeves rolled up and very ragged. And the teacher said, "Johnny, take it off." And he said, "Teacher, don't make me take off my coat. I'll take my whipping, but please don't make me take off my coat." And as he stood there, the teacher said, "Johnny, you must. I wish you didn't, but you must." And they pulled his coat off, and to the astonishment of all of them, he didn't have on his shirt. And as he stood there with his back bare, the teacher said, "Johnny, I hate to do this worse than anything I've ever done. Why don't you have a shirt?" And he said, "Teacher, as I told you, mama's dead and my daddy's not able to work and look after us, and I didn't have a shirt this morning to wear to school. So they pinned this old coat on me, and I wanted to come to school so bad, and they sent me anyway." And the teacher said, "Nevertheless, Johnny, I'll have to whip you. I'll have to lay these 15 lashes on your back." And as he raised the switch he had in his hand to lay the lashes on his back, the rod, to the surprise of everyone, the boy who had been so unruly and made this rule stepped up with tears in his eyes and said, "Teacher, don't hit him." And he stepped out down the aisle and said, "Here," and began to take off his own coat and to pull off his shirt and said, "Teacher, I'll take his place. Here, whip me for him. Thank God for that love of God, and for you and for I. Jesus took our place. By the grace of God, he took the whipping, that belong to you and I. God bless you.